finance minister Nirmala Sitharaman has asked public sector lenders to take stock of credit disbursal to MSMEs under the emergency credit line scheme. Now this was announced as part of the larger Atmanirbhar Bharat economic package. The finance minister's advised banks to maintain a proactive outreach at the branch level. Remember, the union cabinet had approved the scheme on the 21st of May, and so far banks have sanctioned loans worth 20,000 crore rupees under the scheme. The finance minister has also advised bankers to keep forms for the scheme simple and formalities at the minimum. The government's mega 3 trillion rescue package for micro, small and medium-sized businesses is faced with implemental challenges, though, as lenders continue to be cautious about lending to small businesses due to the poor demand outlook as well as risk aversion. They're also grappling with liquidity challenges of their own. On the other hand, MSMEs themselves don't seem to be that enthused either. A survey of over 46,000 enterprises by the All India Manufacturing Organization, a federation of MSMEs, says that 78% are not satisfied with the execution of the financial package. And while most have cheered the stimulus amount, they feel that it has not percolated down to beneficiaries fast enough, and it may not benefit 85% constituents of the sector. Hello and welcome to Iron India. I'm Shireen Bhan. Joining me now to discuss the government's package for the MSME and the NBFC sectors. Joining me on the show to decode the implementation roadmap for these packages are Sanjeev Chandha, the Managing Director and the CEO of Bank of Baroda, Rajiv Sabharwal, the MD and CEO of Tata Capital, and Sachin Seth, the Partner and Digital Practice Leader at Financial Services EY India. Gentlemen, thanks very much for joining us. Mr. Chandha, let me start by asking you, the Finance Minister had a review meeting with all public sector banks to get a status check on where things currently stand as far as these schemes announced under the Atmanirbhar package. Give me a sense of what the Bank of Baroda has been able to do under these schemes so far.
So, thank you, Shireen. I think this scheme, which is for guaranteeing the 20% incremental exposures to SMEs, this possibly is the centerpiece of the finance minister's package, and one which will make the most immediate and the largest impact on the ground. For us, it's very important as a bank, because MSMEs are a very large component of our total lending book. Within that, the segment which the scheme seeks to address, companies which have a turnover of up to 100 crores, lending up to 25 crores, that book for us is nearly 60,000 crores.
Yeah.
So we're looking at a very large part of the bank's business.
Okay.
And therefore, we believe that this scheme is not only in the interest of the companies concerned, but also the bank, to the extent that it helps these companies to survive these difficult times. So we are looking at that in this perspective, that we need to help the companies and we need to help ourselves to make sure that these companies stay afloat in these difficult times.
Yes. So since you said that this amounts to almost 60,000 crore rupees as far as Bank of Baroda's book is concerned, the MSME segment, help me understand, sir, how much of this is already availed of the moratorium facility that has been announced by the Reserve Bank of India? And also, how much have you been able to sanction and disburse after the guidelines were announced for these packages?
As far as the moratorium is concerned, we had an opt-out clause, which meant that for most market segments, we had given a moratorium across the board, unless a client chose not to avail of the moratorium. So, to my mind, when it comes to MSMEs, it would be a very, very large percentage. Now, as far as this scheme is concerned, this is again something which is going to be non-discriminatory across the board. So, we have got something like 577,000 clients who come under the scheme. So we have sent out pre-approved sanctions to each of these clients, and we have contacted them through SMSs and emails. Of course, when it comes to actual disbursements, you would need to have documentation, and that would be over the next few weeks. But in terms of the applicability of the scheme and approvals, they are pre-approved letters which have gone to each of those 577,000 clients.
Okay, so the disbursal hasn't started just yet, but would it be fair to assume, and I'm going back to my conversation with Uday Kotak a couple of days ago, where he said that he expects that this scheme will be fully sort of executed on by the banking sector closer to September. Would that be the timeline that you're working with as well?
First of all, the disbursement has started. So we're looking at some thousands of clients who have already been disbursed these loans, and on every day disbursals are happening. I would like to believe that we should be able to execute quicker than this, I hope, for the simple reason that this is a need which is imperative, and in case the banks are willing to lend, and also the client is in a position to borrow, I don't see why they should wait up to September. Typically, these clients are spread over our entire network. So we have got something like 9,000 plus branches, right. 18 zones, and no zone account for more than 10% of the client base, which means that we should be able to leverage pretty much our entire network to reach out to these clients. And I would like to believe that we should do it significantly quicker than September.
Okay, significantly quicker, and you're saying that disbursements have started. I'm going to come back to you and try and get a number out from you on what the picture as far as disbursements are concerned as of the 10th of June. But let me bring Rajiv Savaral into the conversation as well. As far as NBFCs are concerned, Rajiv, what is the situation? What seem to be the execution challenges that you're grappling with today?
No, we've looked at the scheme. There were certain FAQs also brought out by NCGTC, which helped clarify a lot of things. First of all, let me compliment them. The scheme has been designed pretty well. There are one or two clarifications which we are still seeking from them, but the scheme has been designed well. We are also hopeful of...
what kind of clarifications are you still seeking?
So there are a couple of things, a couple of important things which we felt. One is that, when we were giving 20% more loans, we are seeking whether this, what the current scheme says is that you can apply to get the monies back under this guarantee if the loan, post the loan becoming an NPA.
Yeah.
If the loan becomes an NPA, right. What we would prefer is that these monies can come before the loan becomes an NPA, once it's 60 days past you rather than 90 days past you, because otherwise you will have to make this account as an NPA in your books. And second is the fact that, once it becomes an NPA, it'd be good if 100% of the money, which is being guaranteed comes rather than 75%. The 25% of the monies is supposed to come later, once you've exhausted all your legal means, which could take years. So, in such a guarantee, what would be preferable is to get the monies upfront. There's a third clarification which we've sought, which is on, once an account becomes an NPA and you claim these monies, and post that through your recovery efforts, you start getting your monies back. We believe that once the monies come back, they should be appropriated pari passu between the earlier loan and the new loan given. Currently, it says that they will be appropriated first to the new loan and then to the earlier loan. So these are some of the clarifications which we have sought, from the body. But otherwise, we feel the scheme is designed well, and we do feel that we will see a lot more of disbursements happening starting July.
Starting July, you expect disbursements to start. But yeah. Sachin, let me ask you now. Let me ask you about what you believe are the key challenges when we talk about implementation and execution. Rajiv Sabharwal just laid out for us some of the key clarifications that they're waiting to hear and post which they assume that in July the dispersal process will kick off. But what to your mind are the key challenges that the industry is still grappling with?
Sure, Shreem. Thank you. Thank you for the question. So, first of all, I echo the same sentiment that what Rajiv and what Mr. Chandra said, that the scheme is pretty good. It's well in time, and the package, the size of the package, the mechanism, etc., has been well laid out, well thought out. So, I must say that it's a great job done by government. But like everything, devil lies in the detail of execution. So, from execution perspective, what we are seeing is that there are areas which could have been slightly better, or they could be better even now going forward. So, if you look at a couple of examples, like there is a limit that consolidated borrowing of the the borrower on a date of 29th Feb should be 25 crore. Now, if you do in a manual process right now, which is what we see is happening, every lender is looking at their own exposure. It's difficult to arrive at that number. So there should be certain system or digital mechanism we could have used, or we can use it now, wherein we can create a platform very quickly. And that platform could become like a view for Ministry of Finance, Ministry of MSME, for the bankers and for SIDBI, for basically to be able to see that who are the eligible borrowers, where are they applying for, what offers they are accepting from, and basically what kind of disbursals are happening. Because otherwise what's happening, couple of key issues what we are seeing is that one is visibility, cutoff dates, etc. And second point also that the NOCs which may be required, because the rate of interest of the bank is 9.25%, whereas the rate of NBFC is 14. So if there is an MSME which has option to take from both, where the MSME will go to, and if there is an NOC required between the parties, how that will happen. So I would say the whole purpose of this scheme is to execute fast, because as unlocking 1.0 is happening, people will queue up for the money. And that's where I think a digital and technology platform, there's a need to put in place very quickly by a centralized agency, because otherwise it will become like any other scheme, and then it may have a challenge of basically looking at the speed of execution as a key thing to be desired.
Shane, if I can add,
let me take that up. Yes.
Yeah. Sachin is saying, we are moving from a high touch model to a low touch model because of what the challenges in the market are. So we believe that moving completely to digital or video KYC is extremely essential. So all NBFCs should be allowed to use the digital KYC or the video KYC model and help hasten the process. Similarly, when we are seeking NOCs from other lenders, rather than going through the physical process or email process, all of this should be done digitally. If a portal can be there where all the lenders can give their NOCs or not give, whichever way they want, then this whole process will become faster. So both on the KYC side as well as on the NOC side, we can completely move to the digital world.
Okay. That is a key ask there, Sachin as well as Rajiv Sabharwal putting that point forward. But Mr. Chadha, let me ask you, because the pitch from the finance minister to public sector banks was also very clear: keep it simple, make it as less cumbersome as possible for the customer, so that this can actually move very quickly, sir. To the point that Rajiv and Sachin were making on the NOC procurement and making that faster, what's the way forward? Has any key decisions been taken post that meeting yesterday or in that meeting yesterday with the finance minister?
So when we look at our customer profile, and we look at the people whom we are seeking to address, typically with these size of borrowers, you would have an arrangement which would be pretty much sole banking for most of them. So you would go out making consortia for borrowers which are put 25 crore limits. So to my mind, and you're absolutely right, there will be cases which do not answer to the description, but to my mind, for an overwhelming majority of our clients, we would be the sole bankers and we should be able to address the issue. Also, we need to appreciate that these are clients with whom you have daily interactions. You receive their checks, you receive their payments, they come to present bills. So there is an interaction which is always going to be there. So I don't see that much of a challenge, simply because we also do transaction banking. You already have security created, you already have documents executed. So I do believe it is something that can be handled, because this is something that you have been doing in any case. Having said that, there is no doubt that the world is changing. The way that we will be doing business even with these MSMEs is going to change, and digitization is something which is inevitable. So if we take this as an opportunity to accelerate the process and do things which should be done in any case, I think it would be a good idea.
Okay. Mr. Chadha, let me also ask you about how you see this panning out and whether you believe that this is going to be enough. What is the outlook as far as recovery is concerned? B, how concerned would you be about the health of the MSME sector? You already spoke about the large moratorium that has been availed of by your clients. So what's the outlook on both recovery as well as the possibility of higher NPAs on this book?
So I think one thing which we need to possibly appreciate is that we have had a tough economic climate over the last few years. And these are NBFC clients who have been with banks and who have weathered this storm. What we have seen, of course, is cataclysmic. So what you need to do in the first instance is to reach out to make sure that they have got the means to survive these months, which is where, again, this particular guaranteed line, and prior to this also the emergency lines that we put into place, come in. These are things that you can pretty much, without applying any very detailed, sophisticated criteria in terms of assessment, actually reach out and you can make sure you can help borrowers. But you're absolutely right. This is something which is going to be there here and now, which is something that you can do based upon your current information. But over the next few months, you will need to engage with these MSMEs very closely, understand the situation of each one of them, and they would very possibly, for a significant percentage of those clients, need to be some kind of reset, some kind of restructuring. But that can only be once the current situation stabilizes, and you also have some visibility in terms of when are you going to return to normal. You cannot do a restructuring scheme without understanding where you are going to end up.
Right.
So I think in the current circumstances, this was the right thing to do. We will make sure that we focus all our energies to delivering on this. And during this process, we can understand the ongoing requirements of the client, understand from them what more we can do for them down the line. I think that will be very useful.
So you believe that the restructuring option, which is the big demand that's coming across the board from industry, is an option that the RBI and banks will have to consider perhaps post-August? Would that be a fair estimate of the timeline? Because the lockdown is now sort of on its way out. Businesses are trying to get back to a degree of normalcy. Post-August, do you believe that that would be an appropriate time to review?
I think that would be a fair assessment. Between the emergency credit facility that we are discussing now and the moratoria which have been allowed to clients, I think we should be able to see through this difficult period. And given the fact that the lockdown is now lifted and progressively activity should get back to normal, we should be able to identify that what exactly is the gap in terms of the cash flows of the companies and look at restructuring then. And I'm sure at that point in time, whatever forbearance is required from the regulators, that should be forthcoming.
Well, we will have to wait to see what the regulator decides to do. There is, of course, that issue of moral hazard, which the regulator is going to have to grapple with, and perhaps that is holding the regulator's hand back. But Rajiv Sabharwal, let me ask you, as far as the outlook for NBFCs are concerned, on the back of the measures that have been announced so far, now with the restart button that's been pressed for the economy, what is the outlook? What's the situation on the ground?
Let me just first add one point to what Mr. Chadha mentioned. I completely agree with what he said. The other thing I would like to add is I think as a comment, we also need to work towards ensuring that there is some stimulus for demand too. For example, the MSMEs will do well when they're, to whom they supply, those companies start doing well, which means that demand for the final product should come through. Whether it is the auto industry, whether it is the construction industry, in the infra industry, all of these, if the demand starts getting generated there, then automatically the products which the bigger companies make, to whom the MSMEs supply, will start moving. So while this 20% will help kickstart the business, but there may be higher requirement both in terms of working capital and because working capital cycles could also get stretched at this point of time. So all of this we will need to look at once the whole kickstart happens. But parallelly, we have to work towards stimulating demand. That's going to be extremely essential. As far as NBFCs are concerned, I think today there is liquidity in the market. There is money which is available in the market. I think today we have to look at finding the right opportunities to lend. That is going to be extremely important. The other thing which everybody is going to watch for is, post this whole moratorium 2 ending, how soon can things become normal? That's going to be essential.
What is the indication that you're getting? We've now seen a very difficult period of the complete lockdown starting to ease, relaxations coming in pretty much across the board. What's the first cut that you're picking up from the ground in terms of demand revival?
So, first of all, as we always say, we are one India, but there are, different parts behave differently. So today also we are seeing this, that while in Mumbai, the state of lockdown is very different. When you go in deeper markets and when you talk to people there, the situation is not as bad. Things have opened up. There is buying which is happening, especially in the rural markets or in the semi-urban markets. The situation is far better. People can move around. The way I have seen it, things started changing from let me say post 20th May or so. In the last 7 to 10 days of May, things started opening up. People could go out. People could buy things. Like for example, when you look at two-wheeler sales, compared to what they used to sell earlier, they are already up there with about 20% of that. So sales is improving. I think so. June is going to be better. So we are looking at the positive side that things, with the government allowing things to open up, things will become better. But for them to reach the steady state is going to take time. I feel in next 3 months, we probably could see coming back to 50% of what we were in the past.
Okay, so the next 3 months will be crucial to see whether this pent-up demand that we are seeing across some categories and in some pockets of India, it's not a consistent picture. Whether this is going to be sustainable and long-lasting is the question. But Sachin, on the back of feedback that you're getting from clients, etc., what's the outlook, especially when it comes to the financial services space?
Yeah, Shireen. So I think obviously from our clients' perspective, we are seeing that some areas the pickup of demand is happening, and especially with unlock down one happening, essential goods or basically some of the clusters are coming back. In obviously the pockets which are green zones or the orange zones, and so we do see that it will pick up. But I think right now, because the supply chain is broken and it is end-to-end supply chain works to serve any industry. So as Rajiv mentioned that, some of the areas need to be looked at, that how, the end-to-end chain can be supported, whether it's auto or whether it is textile or other sectors.
Right.
And basically then the whole ecosystem can work, because this right now, we had a well-oiled machinery working before the COVID-19. I think that there have been the gaps which have been created because of COVID-19. And I guess financial services support could be there, but I think there are more things which could also be required to plug the gaps.
Mr. Chadha, I'll end things by asking you what your outlook is in terms of recovery, and especially when it comes to credit offtake. Also, we were talking to S.N. Subramaniam of L&T, and he believes that private sector investment is unlikely to pick up for the next year and a half. In light of that, sir, what does the outlook look like then for credit offtake?
So I think it's inarguable that when it comes to investment demand, it was weak and it will take time to come back. But having said that, as Raju was mentioning, there is the fact that working capital cycles are being extended. There are cash flow gaps which are there. So even as we speak today, for us, YOY growth today is about 9%. And the kind of dip that we normally saw in the months of April and May, we don't see that. Partly it is, of course, because companies are trying to be safe. They are drawing facilities just to make sure that there are enough buffers and cushions which are there. So I would tend to believe that if you're looking at the short to medium term, possibly the credit demand is there. Mm-hmm. But yes, I think if you were to look at the trend rates, I think there would be some kind of softness for next couple of years.
Next couple of years? You expect the softness to continue for the next couple of years, Mr. Chadha?
So the logic again is that once companies again, after making sure that they avail of leverage to build cushions, right? Even NBFCs again are accessing markets, they have debt programs, because they want to make sure that even if things were to worsen, they have the liquidity cushions which are available. Now, I do hope that over a period of time, the need for this kind of sobriety and the need for this conservatism might go away, in which case you probably would run down the liquidity. To that extent, there may be some impact after that period.
Okay. Rajiv, a quick last question to you. You said that you believe that there is need for more stimulus from the government to try and support demand. Now, so far, in light of the schemes that have been announced by the government, it seems more on the support side as opposed to the stimulus side, that the government believes that this should be adequate to spur demand as well. But do you foresee this being enough if there isn't more?
See, I think the FM clearly, when she outlined that whole program, and it was quite a detailed program covering a lot of segments, she did mention that she will continue to watch the situation and take appropriate steps when necessary.
Yeah.
I feel the first agenda of the government has been to kickstart the economy back, and that is where the unlocking is happening. That's where this emergency credit line is happening, so that the working capital cycles, which were jammed, start moving in. Post that, we believe that as and when things start opening up, if there is a need to do anything, we believe there will be support coming in. What is very essential, according to me, is one, to ensure that there is enough liquidity which is available and the system gets that liquidity. Parallelly, we have to bring the confidence back in the system of the buyers too. And how do we get it? Stimulus could be one. There could be other ways of getting them. But we have to get the confidence of the buyers. People are holding on to bigger decisions. And that is that unlocking in the minds of the customer also needs to be done.
Yes, and that unlocking perhaps will not happen till the time that there is some degree of stability when it comes to the COVID crisis, as well as some degree of stability when it comes to an outlook for job security and financial security. So that's all sort of connected and linked together. But for this evening, Sanjeev Chadha, Rajiv Sabharwal and Sachin Seth, appreciate you joining us on the special edition of Eye on India to evaluate and assess the packages announced for the MSME and NBFC sectors by Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman, what's working on the ground and what more needs to be done. Quick break, there's a lot more coming up. Don't go anywhere, we're back in a moment.